And hello everyone, and now that we have talked about Islamic empires, let's talk about the achievements of those empires. And where the Muslims just blew it up was trade, just absolutely unrivaled in trade. Remember, Muhammad was a merchant, so being a merchant is seen as like one of the best or almost holy type professions. And there were a variety of things that really helped them expand this trade. One was actual paper. Paper would be imported from China, and paper was actively, of course, used in books, but used to keep track of financial records and actively used to spread knowledge. And some of the biggest pieces of knowledge, if you will, had to do with sailing and transport. So that is going to be huge. But for overland trade, you have the domestication of the camel. I mean, this is huge. And not only did they domesticate the camel, they developed a special saddle that would allow the camel to carry huge loads of cargo without actually hurting it. And what you end up having happen is this helps with the trade through, say, parts of Iran and Afghanistan. But what it also does is it massively opens up trade in areas of the world such as the Northern Sahara Desert, which is going to be really, really important. And we're going to be talking about this moving forward. But the Sahara has gold and salt and unfortunately some slaves. But Muslim trade is just going to blow all of this up. And so that's going to be really, really kind of important as we move forward. Also, they take sailing to all new levels. First, you have the massive use of the lateen sail. Now, the lateen sail actually goes all the way back to the Mesopotamians, but it was really the Muslims that kind of take that sail to the next level. They expand it, they make it much larger, and a lateen, as you see here, it's this triangular sail, which actually can catch the wind better, which can make you move faster, and just overall, it's a really important advance. As a result, you get the creation of the Muslim dhow, which is that ship that you see on the right, which is a really incredible ship that is able to do quite a lot of things because it can carry lots of cargo. Now, these guys were also big on astronomy and using the sun and stars to allow them to navigate. And the two things that they will actually use, they did not invent, but they will use and improve upon, will be the astrolabe and the compass. The astrolabe will allow you to measure the position of stars, which allows you to get your latitude, which is crucial in actually mapping sea routes. And then they are also going to expand the use of the magnetic compass, which will help them travel in north and south. And overall, they could pretty much travel anywhere and everywhere. They also will expand upon banking. You will see banking that is very similar to what we use today. These banks would create the concept of letters of credit, which means you could deposit your money, or these are Abbasid coins, in a bank in Samarkand. They would give you a paper indicating how much you put in there with a kind of cipher on it or a code. You would then take that to a bank in Baghdad and could withdraw your money. And what that allows is for you to travel with less money, which makes it safer, which makes it less likely when the robbers come at you, because they're going to come, that you lose everything. They also did currency exchange, so that allowed people to trade and use money in areas in which they were, you know, more effective. And they could use local money, which was really, really important. It's kind of the basis of what we use today. We also have new business ideas. They start to use the concept of investors that would come together to put money in so that people could go on journeys. The Europeans would do this later. It's almost like a, you know, kind of like a ancient medieval, not ancient medieval, but like a medieval Shark Tank, if you will, in which people came together. You had business partnerships, and again, the Silk Roads will be in full flourish here. As we can see, I mean, look at this type of stuff. You're going from you know, Peking, Yangshao, and Guangzhou, there's this sea route all the way across. And look at how much of that area the Muslims control. They also control this trade going back down to Timbuktu that we talked about during the Byzantines and all the way up here to modern day Belgium. So we go from Belgium to North Africa to the Middle East down to East Africa, across the Arabian Sea and the Bay of Bengal, the Indian Ocean, and back again over land. And the Muslims were at the center of it, and it made them tremendously wealthy. They also expanded religion and law. You have the development of a group of people known as ulama, who were your missionaries who went out to spread the faith. And really, the most successful areas that they're going to get into is this is the time period they will get into India, as well as moving on to Southeast Asia, and eventually getting to Indonesia, which of course is actually the largest Muslim country in the world today. They will also be big on schooling on the right there, or a madras. That is a Abbasid school, quite beautiful. And in schooling, they would work in the madras. They would work in reading and writing, theology, law, and science. You could go to university. And it's the Muslims that were actually the savior of much of the ancient Greek knowledge that would help us in the future, and the Roman knowledge as well, as they advanced it. You also had the impact of the Sufis, okay? These are kind of religious men similar to monks, because Islam really didn't have any priests, and they would also help people learn the religion. And so the ulama are helping to spread it. The monks are going to educate people on it. And you really start to see the spread of this religion just going on and on and on. And then you also have a group of people called the Qadis, which their job was to spread and enforce Muslim law. So their job is to study the Quran, to study Shia law, and spread that knowledge amongst the people that were starting to convert to Islam. And it was really having a tremendous impact. So we have the spread of religion, we have the spread of knowledge. It is really just a booming area. And, you know, when we look at their advances, you know, math, medicine, and philosophy are going to be huge. Let's start with math. It is the Arabs that will adopt the Indian numbers that we actually know and use today, and will expand upon them. So our math system comes from that. And then, you know, they invented a little thing called algebra. They expanded upon Euclidean geometry, and then they also brought us trigonometry, mathematical things that we use in every day. This is huge to eventually getting the creation of calculus, which is the big game changer. But we use algebra, geometry, and trigonometry in almost every type of profession today. I know you don't think you use algebra, but the concept of problem solving is there. It leads to engineering, and it all comes from the Muslims. Oh, let's do some medicine as well. Their most famed doctor was a man by the name of Avicenna, who was Ibn Sina, who the Greek name for him is Avicenna. He really helped to transform medicine. It was under Avicenna that they create the world's first medical encyclopedias, that doctors should treat symptoms. They also developed the theories behind the circulatory system. Now, it was an Englishman, William Harvey, that would officially figure everything out, but they did have some ideas of how, like, blood moves through the lungs and things like that. They also developed most of our plant-based medicines, and it's actually the Muslims that we credit with developing the idea of the pharmacy. They also used anesthesia and antiseptics. They knew that you had to keep stuff clean. They're one of our first societies that will use the ideas of antiseptics very effectively. They will often use wine or something like that, but we know alcohol can clean some things up. And when you went to a Muslim hospital that you see on the right, that's a hospital that's about 800 years old, that there was a pretty good chance that you were going to get better. Whereas if you went to hospitals in Europe, I want to say all the way through the 15, 16, 17, even 1800s, there was a much greater chance that you would get sick and die from going to the hospital than for what you actually went there for. All of it brought from the Muslims in the Middle Ages. And then we have philosophy. This guy by the name of Ibn Rushd, who is known in the West as Averroes. He lived from 1126 to 1198, and he is crucial because he did a lot of things for us. One, he translated and commented on Aristotle, that he brought together the ideas of Aristotle to try to get a deeper understanding of them and taught particularly those ideas of logic and scholasticism. Because what his goal was to blend the ideas of philosophy and rationality with religion, that philosophy can support religion. And in the end, Averroes had always said from his writings that his goal was to show that basically philosophy or science and religion both have the same end, and that end is truth. And in the end, it would be incredibly successful. He would really take Muslim philosophy and learning to the next level. He inspired a lot of doctors to do this type of study as well. And the biggest person he influenced was Thomas Aquinas, who is considered the greatest writer of all the Middle Ages in Europe, and his influence on philosophy and religion. Well, he was influenced by Averroes, and he had the works of Averroes as well. And so when we look at the achievements of the Muslims, they are staggering. In a time where Europe is dark and China's in a bit of transition, it's the Muslim world that was kind of the shining light, and they really brought us a lot of things that we see today. Okay, make sure to get your questions and your comments, and I'll see you guys tomorrow.